If you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain how I found out about this. It's free. It's on your app store. There's a creation tool that allows you to record and edit your podcast right now from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place. Please, I urge you, don't waste another minute. I wasted 3 years. I attended all kinds of events to learn all the steps. I was so confused, and it was right here. Download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started. Do it now. If you obey all the rules, you'll miss all the fun. That's a quote by Katharine Hepburn. For the Heart and Home podcast, I am Sabah Fakhoury on this Sunday, March 21, 2021, our second day of spring, and spring has sprung in Miami Beach, where crowds descended on that area, and they weren't obeying all the rules, so now the city of Miami Beach has declared a state of emergency. An 8 p.m. curfew was imposed by Miami Beach Mayor on Saturday in South Beach, the entertainment district, and that was because the area was overwhelmed with spring break crowds Friday night, with partying and street fights and trashed restaurants, all this without wearing masks or social distancing, while parts of South Florida continue to be hotspots for COVID-19. The 8 p.m. curfew affects South Beach's main commercial strip, Ocean Drive, Washington Avenue, Espanola Way, from 5th to 16th Streets. And area restaurants, which were able to deliver till 6 a.m., can no longer make food deliveries past midnight now. So if you're there, you have a hotel room, you can hang out there, but as far as going out after 8 o'clock, no. Not going to happen. A few corrections I would like to bring to your attention from yesterday's Heart and Home podcast. I erroneously reported that Elsias R. Hernandez Ortiz, 30, of Acworth, Georgia, that he had died. Unfortunately, that was an error in the reports that I had gotten. His wife had told the Washington Post that her husband, who was injured in the attack, called her after being shot outside of Young's Asian Massage. He was in intensive care. He has survived. He was shot in the head, and he actually has a bullet in his stomach that they can't remove right now. She believes that he was on his way to send money to his parents in Guatemala when he was caught in the gunfire. So I apologize for that mistake. I know that sometimes errors happen, and unfortunately, I picked up bad information. I kept searching and searching, and I could not find it anywhere else, and I can't remember the source that I got it from. But anyways, I'm trying to correct that today. Also, I made an error in my report yesterday in when I spoke about Mayor of Detroit getting in trouble because he rejected, I had said AstraZeneca, and I misspoke. It was Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which has yet to be approved in the United States. So if I make any other mistakes, please let me know. It happens, and we always try to issue corrections so that everybody is aware that mistakes do happen, and we don't do it on purpose. And we try to correct it in either the next day or in the show notes once we realize that it is inaccurate. Okay, so let's get on with things. We're not going to go over everything that happened because yesterday's Heart and Home kind of recapped what had happened all of this week. So we still have protests continuing due to anti-Asian sentiments. And so now we're going to get to back to the real stories that I had promised you on the continuing coverage of the fallout for Oprah Winfrey's interview with the former Sussex, which aired March 7 on CBS with Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. Now, today I will focus on Sharon Osbourne because her career is at question right now. We don't know what's going to happen with her. But a new development happened, and we'll get to recapping of the situation that Sharon's in. Now, Sharon Osbourne is one of the co-hosts of The Talk, which is on CBS, as we mentioned. And CBS was also the network that aired the Oprah interview. And one of the hosts, Elaine Welteroth, this is a different host than the one that Sharon had gotten into a heated argument with that caused CBS to put their program, which is live, into production hiatus. So first they went into hiatus for 2 days, then they extended it to another week, which would take us to Tuesday of this week. And I believe that's also now been extended by CBS until an internal investigation is concluded. So it seems that Elaine, one of the other hosts, has now filed a complaint about Sharon Osbourne. Now, this comes, this was, I think, on the 16th or so. So what happened is, not just Elaine, but her hairstylist have both said that they don't feel comfortable working in a racially insensitive and hostile environment. So there's other things that have happened. It's not just her that have come out. So this, aside from Sharon saying, hey, I want an internal investigation about what happened, now other people have begun to speak out. So I don't know if Sharon's actually going to come back. This is just not looking good at all. She's had complaints from other hosts that have also left the show. And we'll get into that in just a moment. So it looks like CBS has a lot on their hands because we've got the emotional outburst that Sharon had with Cheryl. And then now we have Elaine coming in, another Black co-host on the show, who's filed the complaint with CBS Human Resources. And she's saying that about Osbourne's comments to co-host Sheryl Underwood. And so now she's starting an internal investigation into the conduct, despite Sharon Osbourne saying she wanted an investigation about which CBS top executive told her co-hosts to ask questions that Ms. Osbourne claims caught her off guard. Okay, anyways, as I said, other complaints have come forward, and they include some pretty damaging, and it's not looking good for Ms. Osbourne because of, well, it's not only involving racism, what she did wrong, upsetting African-American co-hosts, now other co-hosts of Asian-American background and another African-American have also come forward about mistreatment. Other people are saying, you know, Sharon has a history of, you know, kind of bad-mouthing other people. And I don't know, CBS, what they're going to do with her. It is not looking good. So what happened is that there were some reports that came out that involved Yasher Ali. He's a New York Magazine Huffington Post contributor. And he started coming out with all kinds of reports. So he had some exclusive reports in which he said that Sharon Osbourne frequently referred to Julie Chen as, quote, wanton and slanty eyes, unnamed sources. So that was something that has now developed and it has been new. In addition to all the other co-hosts that have come out that were also complaining about being let go. Now, I don't know if I should say this, but there's more. Sharon Osbourne, the co-host of the CBS daytime panel show, The Talk, would frequently refer to then co-host Julie Chen, who's Chinese American, not just as wanton and slanty eyes, but she also referred to Sara Gilbert, who's a lesbian, as a, quote, pussy licker and fish eater, according to multiple sources, including Leah Remini, who is a former co-host. This is getting really bad, okay? Really bad. Now, we all know about the whole issue about Miss Osbourne, who's facing criticism because she, you know, publicly supported her friend, British TV personality, Piers Morgan. She's accused Meghan Markle, the former Duchess of Sussex, of lying about having suicidal thoughts and doubted her accounts of racism within the royal family and their court. But also appearing defensive and angry and ordering one of her co-hosts to not cry when asked about the blowback during a segment on The Talk. Okay, so that's what landed Sharon Osbourne into trouble with Sharon. With Sheryl. Ugh, again, that tongue twister. So that launched the investigation and that is still yet to be, we don't know what's going to happen with that situation. But now all these other revelations that are coming out in a politically incorrect time are not looking good for Ms. Osbourne. So I don't know if she's even going to come back, you guys. Now, after reports came out, a spokesperson for CBS declined to comment. Of course, whenever there's an internal investigation, they can't say anything. So these are bombshell after bombshell, and it's just getting worse and worse and worse. And I feel so bad. But, you know, you can't just mouth off and say what you want and mistreat people. And I know that some people, that's their style. They always, you know, I mean, that's just, you can't just say, okay, that's her. It just, after a while, people have to just say, okay, look it, enough is enough. And I think CBS has reached that limit where they just say, look it, we cannot continue to let this person talk from both sides of her mouth. This is affecting their CBS brand, and they have to do something. And whenever there's a complaint, any company automatically has to investigate. That's the norm, regardless where you work. It's just something that's part of corporate America. And then from there, they'll let you know of what they find. But what they have to do is they have to talk to all the parties, get everybody's side of the story. They have to listen. And then once they air out all the complaints, then the company will come to a decision as far as what to do with their employees. So I don't know, maybe they'll cancel the whole show, or maybe Sharon's out. I don't know. We have not heard anything about what happens with the situation when you have a disagreement of co-hosts, whether one will be released and the show continues, or whether they just shut down everything. So on Sunday, today, CBS officials announced the talk would go on a short hiatus while an internal review of Wednesday's episode is held. So in a statement, the network said, "We're committed to a diverse, inclusive, and respectful workplace." But online, it was getting heated. In a tweet posted Friday regarding the contentious exchange between Sharon Osbourne and Sheryl Underwood, Robinson Peet also chimed in with her complaints of being fired because she was, quote, called as ghetto, too ghetto for the show. All this stuff is coming up. And, you know, when things happen like this, that's when people come and air their complaints. So, I mean, they have a right to bring them up, whether they were fired for that reason or not. If someone still is reeling from something that happened to them, then they're going to bring them up, and then they're going to talk to a reporter who's then going to come back out and say, okay, you know what, this is just too much to deal with. Now, Osbourne has tweeted in response to Robinson Peet's accusation, claiming, "She never in my life did I utter the words that Holly was too ghetto to be on the talk, as well as not having her fired." Okay, so we don't know exactly what happened as far as why Robinson Peet was fired. That's a side issue. Now, Osbourne has told Variety of the accusation. "It's an absolute lie, 110% lie. I cannot have anyone fired. And that is not a term I use. That's not in my vocabulary. I don't speak like that. The only ghetto I know is the Warsaw ghetto. And I think that's the only time I've ever referred to something like that." Well, somebody, by the way, found a clip of her talking to somebody while on the show that said, "Oh, that's ghetto." It wasn't directed to Robinson Peet at that time, but Sharon has uttered those words on live back several years ago. Okay, so Sharon Osbourne's in hot trouble, and everything that's going on has caused a lot of pain within the staff, with management. It's just something that is not going too well for that show. So that is up in the air. We might find out this week what's going to happen. But we have too many players between Sharon Osbourne, her co-hosts, and now previous hosts, Gilbert, Chen, Remini, Robinson, Peet. I mean, it's just too much. These women, I mean, supposedly they were friends. They thought they had each other's back. Now Sharon is claiming that she was, you know, set up, and she actually went out and had an interview with ET in an exclusive with the gentleman's name is Kevin Frazier, and we'll have a clip for you on that.
Why'd you want to sit down and talk today?
Oh gosh, there's so many stories, you know, and I want to explain what happened.
I'm not racist. Neither is Piers racist.
Walk us through what happened on Wednesday.
Wednesday, I arrived at the studio late. One of our showrunners was going up the stairs. She said, "Do you want to clear up the Piers thing again?" I said, "Hey, if you want me to, I will." Then at 8 minutes to 11, our showrunner says, how do you feel about maybe one of them doesn't agree with you? And I said, well, that's all right, too. Okay, thanks.
Sharon said what unfolded on air felt like a betrayal from her co-host after a pact they made in February.
There was a situation in February. Carrie Ann was given a question to ask Elaine, and Carrie Ann didn't want to ask it, but it came from the producers to ask Elaine. And it was, if black people can use the N-word, why can't white people use the N-word?
I would love to hear what you have to say.
Which is a very naive question to ask. We all know why. So Elaine got very upset with her response. Carrie Ann started to cry. So we agreed we would never be surprise each other with questions if we thought the other one hadn't been prepped. And we said we will never put ourselves in this situation again where we set each other up. So we all agreed as women, got your back. I finished saying what I'm saying, and then Sheryl asked me these questions, which I didn't know, and they were written questions, and then Elaine's reading her questions.
Stand up for anti-racism.
And I'm like, I've been set up.
Don't try and cry, because if anyone should be crying, it should be me.
And I went like, how dare you all do this to me? I'm your sacrificial lamb. So in the break, I'm like, talk to me, Sheryl. Talk to me. What is going on? She wouldn't. I lost it even further.
Sharon did take to Twitter the next day and apologize, saying, quote, to anyone of color that I offended or let down, I am truly sorry. I panicked. But she did not publicly apologize to Sheryl.
I want you to hear from me.
Do you regret how things spun out of control with Sheryl?
Regret? Oh, my God. Sheryl's my friend of nearly 11 years.
What do you want to say to Sheryl?
I love Sheryl. I love Sheryl. I've apologized to Sheryl. She's not gotten back. And I can understand Sheryl needs her time.
Do you understand how people could look at it and say, you telling her not to cry could look like you are attacking Sheryl?
Oh, I was having a go at my friend. I got too personal with Sheryl. I should never have said about her tears. I should never have dismissed her feelings on national TV, ever. But I said it, I have to own it. And I was so angry. I cannot begin to tell you, not with Sheryl, not with Elaine, not with anybody, but a company that I've worked at for 11 years.
What was the goal, do you think? What was the goal?
Because I think that CBS was so horrified with Piers for the things he was saying. Because remember, Harry and Meghan, it's the CBS interview. I had sided with Piers, so it's the cancel culture, isn't it?
She said the word, cancel culture. Do you see what's happening here? Do you understand what she's trying to tell us? Even though she still might not understand what she did wrong and doesn't understand why she's being called a racist because she came to the aid of her friend, Piers Morgan. Now the issue is CBS, which aired the original interview with Oprah, and The Talk also airs on CBS. Here's the rest of the interview.
Cancel culture, isn't it? Throw her under the bus. Now, two showrunners were crying, and then they said that we were told to ask these questions from the executives. The executives.
Who?
They wouldn't give me names.
I've seen you handle some very hot and hard topics. Why did this throw you?
Because I just felt this is the biggest setup ever, and I'm falling into it, and I'm going deeper down this hole.
A spokesperson for CBS tells ET they are, quote, very mindful of the important concerns expressed and discussions taking place regarding events on The Talk. The show will extend its production hiatus until next Tuesday as we continue to review these issues.
I'm sorry, I don't believe a word she says, Meghan Markle.
For someone with that large of a megaphone, that was unbelievable.
Yeah, I never agreed with it. I agree with his freedom of speech. He's a provocateur. I kept saying, show me where he's been racist. Show me, show me, show me. I don't know. Tell me. Educate me. Let me read it.
Right. But in many ways, that was your job to know his background. Because he's your friend.
He's my friend. And for the times that I have worked with him, I have never, ever been a party to anything in his company that has ever been racist. Ever.
Have you talked to Pierce since this?
Yeah, sure. He checks in on me every day. He feels really bad because me standing up for his right of speech has got me where I am today.
Today, Leah Remini became the second former co-host of Sharon's to accuse her of using racist language at the talk. The season one co-host told journalist Yashir Ali Sharon would refer to Julie Chen, who's Chinese American, as, quote, wanton and slanty eyes. This days after Holly Robinson Peet said Sharon had her fired for being, quote, too ghetto. Sharon denies both claims.
People who are let go along the way get pissed off. I'm the big girl with the big mouth, so they fire it at me. But I'm not a fool. Don't accuse me of something that's a lie.
What do you think they're going to come back with out of this investigation?
All I said was, yeah, I want an investigation. I want to know who was the executive that said to ask me these questions. And I want to know why I was left out to dry on national TV.
What do you want to happen with the show?
I wish that we could go on and have a adult conversation calmly and work it out. But I don't know whether we can. I don't know whether it's gone past that. But I don't know whether I even want to go back. I don't know whether I don't know whether I'm wanted there.
So after the interview, Kevin Frazier is actually, he came under fire for giving a softball interview to Sharon Osbourne, where she largely deflected blame and then suggesting that Holly Robinson Peet and Sheryl Underwood, two of the Black women who were targeted by her, join her for a summit on racism. Actually, in a tweet, Kevin Frazier said, quote, at some point, we all have to reach a point where we can sit together and have tough conversations about race. I don't know what happens next for Sharon Osbourne, but I do know it is time for a meaningful conversation, a learning moment. She is ready. Let's not waste this opportunity to move the narrative forward. Let's get Chris Harrison. Let's get, you know, and he names a couple other people, including Meghan Markle, Sheryl Underwood, Holly Peet. He's saying, you all suggest some names and have a summit. Let's move forward. Oh, well, I don't think so. Actually, Sheryl did respond in her podcast. Even though Sharon hadn't heard from her, here's what Sheryl had to say in her podcast last weekend.
There was some F-bombs dropped.
Ooh,
not F-bomb. By me. Not by me.
Right, no. When Miss O was talking, yeah. There were bleeps.
Yeah.
There were F-bombs dropped, and definitely not by me.
No.
It didn't have to be heated. It didn't have to be argued. And even when the volume was going up, even when the volume, and y'all know me. Y'all know when I get on the microphone and I'm heated, and but then y'all also know when I come down, and y'all make sure she's going to ask for forgiveness. She's going to apologize, but that doesn't make you less than. That makes you stronger. And for me, all I kept thinking was, what could she be going through? My way of thinking is always forgiveness first.
Mm-hmm.
And right beside that is apology. Please forgive me. I am sorry for, right? Those two things go together.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what's in Sharon's heart.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what she's feeling. Only feelings I can control, am I right, Harry Sutherland, are my own.
That is correct. That's right.
That is why I started from the segment to the commercial break to all meetings to when we squashed it.
Okay. So there's another thing that I need to mention. that Yasir Ali had brought up a couple of days ago. He said in 2003, on two different occasions, Sharon Osbourne called Renee Tab, an Iranian American talent agent, a quote, Persian carpet cunt, unquote, after she falsely accused Tab of stealing jewelry that Tab rightfully won at a raffle. Okay. So there was another incident in 2018 where Sharon Osbourne was talking on The View and they were discussing Meghan Markle, and Sharon said, quote, she ain't black. So she told her co-hosts that Meghan Markle is indeed black. Her mother is black. And Sharon said, quote, yeah, I know, but she doesn't look black. So this is also Brian brought up as far as being racist as well. And perhaps that's why CBS is going to take another week of being in hiatus, because it's just not solved. Meanwhile, no one's heard from Sharon Osbourne on her Twitter account. Everything remains the same. She has kept everything up. Her last post was her apology with the pink background. She kept up her post of when she appeared on the BBC defending Pierce. So she hasn't posted anything, and she's kind of gone dark, except for that interview that she had with ET this week. So CBS has left it as, quote, their statement said, CBS is committed to a diverse, inclusive, and respectful workplace across all of our productions. We're also very mindful of the important concerns expressed and discussions taking place regarding events on The Talk. This includes a process where all voices are heard, claims are investigated, and appropriate action is taken where necessary. The show will extend its production hiatus, and so right now they've extended it twice. And I guess we don't know what's going to happen with Sharon, Cheryl, the show. Meanwhile, Pierce has been very busy. But before we get to him, there has been Prince William is trending. There was an exclusive profile in the Sunday Times magazine cover of the Duke of Cambridge that appeared, I guess the reporter Roya Nika, who is a royal reporter, has been working on a piece for weeks, or maybe even months. And so now it just seems very timely that this is coming out and basically saying that Prince Harry was way off mark, and just, you know, bolstering Prince William. His friends are coming to his aid. So basically now Prince William is getting a lot of press as being the other brother that, you know, people haven't heard from. And I guess there's a couple other things that have come out as well, where he's claiming, you know, he's not trapped. Now, the royal correspondent, Roya Nika, she works for the Sunday Times. She's also a presenter, a contributor for the BBC, ITV, which is where Pierce has left, Sky News, CBS, ABC, NBC, CNN, CBC, ZDF, RTL. That girl is very busy. Now, whenever we say a royal correspondent, we have to keep in mind that they usually tout the line of the royal family. So she's interviewed the Prince of Wales, Prince Harry, so she's had a lot of access to the royal family. And so, of course, it will skew as pro-royal. Now, the Sunday Times has done a lot of coverage on the royal family, and you can look to see all the different stories that they've run, and they have not been too kind to Meghan Markle. So that's been going on. Now we're seeing, you know, kind of like we got to fight fire with fire. So Prince William is like speaking out, which is not usual for him. So I'm wondering if he feels that he has to defend himself. He feels that he has to defend his family. Maybe perhaps people are thinking that he's the one that had the conversation with his brother, Prince Harry. We don't know whether it was Prince William, whether it was his father. It could have been Kate. We don't know. But this sudden outspokenness by Prince William, and now this intimate portrait of the future king, well, behind his father, is kind of interesting. So this is something that is normal that you would see in the press. And this is something that we'd expect. He has come out, Prince William, saying, I'm not racist, my family's not racist, and feeling that he had to defend himself, even though his grandmother has said this is an internal family problem. We will discuss it in private. Now, all of a sudden, a piece appeared where people are saying, oh, now Harry is, Prince William has got his black friends that are coming out to his aid, and, you know, kind of like trying to prove like, yeah, he has black friends. And so a piece appeared entitled, My Friend Prince William is No Racist. And so following the Sussexes' Oprah interview, or the former Sussexes, excuse me, Sayi Obakin, who is the CEO of Centerpoint, has published an article about his friendship with Prince William. Now, this is Centerpoint is one of their groups that they work with, and they have said that, you know, he was invited to his wedding. I mean, Prince Harry's wedding, and so. Of course, they're, you know, they support many different groups in Britain. But a few things have been coming to light where some people are saying, look it, for Prince William's 21st birthday, the theme was out of Africa. And guests were allowed to come dressed as bananas and savage Zulu kings. So I don't know. It's not looking too favorable of something that happened, you know, almost 10 years ago. So there are photos floating around of that. And then there's also this whole issue of people that are posting photos of Prince William being bald, you know, like Prince William really cares. I don't know if he's sensitive about that. So that's also being in the press. But, Sayi Obakin, it was the only Nigerian on Prince William's royal wedding guest, not Prince Harry's. And he was one of three Africans invited to the wedding. So I don't know what the reason is for this type of press, but he's coming to the aid of Prince William. Prince William is now also being seen with other African Americans, and his comment of defending his family and himself was actually with another African American when he was making an appearance last week at one of their charities. So all of this is going on, a lot of press. We know that Kate's also in the press. They're trying to be very continuing their support of their work and not worrying about it. Now we have this whole issue coming up of whenever the brothers talk about their mother, that, you know, both of them lost their mom. So even though Prince Harry talks about his mom, now everybody's saying, well, you know, when Prince William talks about his mom, people make big deal about it. You know, they're claiming that Prince Harry is wanting to monopolize on his mom because he's published a book as a tribute to his mom, which is for children who lost their parents and during COVID-19. So, you know, I mean, anything they do is going to be misconstrued. It's just... one person said, look, William can't even mention his mom on Mother's Day, which happened recently in Britain, without people crying PR. But Harry can mention her every time he speaks, and it's totally fine. So, you know, Princess Diana had two sons, not one. So William lost his mom too, and it is painful for him. But it's very interesting that there was a poll that was conducted at YouGov for the Times Red Box, which shows that if the public could choose anyone currently living to Britain's elected head of state, Prince William, the Duke of Cambridge, would be their first choice. He is very popular, and we've all known that his father has never been popular, even as far back as Princess Diana. I mean, I remember she got so much attention that he was so upset. When they would make appearances, they would always say, oh, we want Princess Diana. And he would be like so upset. And he's like saying, well, I need to have two of her so that I can have her on both sides of the street. So anyways, that saga continues. And as far as Pierce, he's having a field day. He has posted to his Instagram that his book, Wake Up, is number 5, which was published in the Sunday Times. And then he did a tongue-in-cheek post after that, where there was a report in the Sunday Sport where a shock exclusive that Roland Rat is going to replace Pierce on Good Morning Britain. So Pierce was making fun of that and saying, well, not such a mad idea. Roland was a massive rating success and likes to speak his mind. He'd also be immune to the cancel culture. So we've got more to report on this, and we are going to leave it for there right now. I hope you're having a wonderful day, and we'll talk to you soon. Have a wonderful, wonderful week.